Certainly.
Yeah, so I thought this would be a great opportunity to do a test. It's a Leaf, it's an electric car, so in that sense, it's maybe that makes a difference, I'm not sure. But I tested it, so I went outside. I can show you some photos later on. So the readings on the road quite high. Sat in the car, put the circulation on, air circulation on, and the fan. So the CO2 levels obviously rose because there's no moving air in there. But the particulates went right down. And that was an interesting observation. I didn't know. I mean, we are still hearing a lot of noise about don't go in the car, it's worse in the car, it's a gas chamber.
Well, how old the cars are, if they've got a pollen filter, so, if you've got this super new car, maybe you've got a more sensitive pollen filter.
I was just about to say, so it's probably, so there is an argument about, you know, the car and insulation of the car as well, and the pollen filter and everything else, right? So it's, you're right, you can't generalise just the cars.
Just a very quick question, did you do any tests to kind of see which one you felt was the most accurate at doing? Because that's one thing that I'm really quite interested in, is both filtration, and you don't need to ask this actually, but filtration, what filtration methods are good and bad, as in having been lab tested or road tested, whatever you want to call it, and the same with these, because I think...
We saw a similar kind of relationship from the black carbon monitor, and the air visual.
That's by far the most accurate, because I think it had rather than just an air sensor, I think there's a laser
right,
sensor
okay.
with it as well.
Yeah.
So yeah, the technology is a bit more advanced in that one than the other two, which are just air sensors. The particles just go across the holes. So there's two holes in the clean space, just about to see them.
Mm.
Just there.
So the bottom two, we could see a relationship, and that's been kind of validated that as well. He said that you would see a direct relationship between these two. So that was evident. The plume is still going through testing phases, and
it's an early prototype basically. Mm. So that was less accurate than the other three.
Mm.
That's the grey one on the top.
Yeah,
there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But when that comes out, I mean, I don't know if you guys have seen the video to the plume. You know, they've advertised it with mums on buggies and you know, in all types of surrounding people on bikes and stuff. And it sounds like, you know, a real groundbreaking device. If it can really deliver on the NO2s and everything else, it'll be a real powerful device, I think. So we're yet to see that. So the first week, the first couple of weeks, we went out with a visual sensor so kids can actually see what we're doing. And we kind of mapped the journeys around the school and kind of just walked around the high street, walked around back streets, and you know, they're straight away they can see what's happening and you know, where is it spiking and where is it not spiking. And there were you know, Captain Isles came in really intrigued in what we were doing. And this is on the high street as it was spiking up. I didn't catch it at a great time, but you know, it's just spiked up over there. The next activity was to ideate through this mapping activity. I'll show you a video later on that kind of explains this a little bit more. But this was really good. So the kids went out on with iPads as well to take photos, and those photos were printed for this session. And what they were able to do is draw connections and map out the ways they're coming to school, map out a certain pollution hotspots, and map out shops and other places, and that for them it was becoming a bit more apparent and better visually for them to understand where they are and how they're coming.
They're also putting down where the good and bad air was and the reasons behind that as well. So I mean, it's fairly, and they got it straight away. You know, there was no, but it was a fun activity for them to map it out in terms of the previous walk that we had done, base it on results of that walk around, so it's based on that scientific approach.
We used the London Air map as well, just to get a snapshot of what it is, what they're looking for as well.
Running it slowly.
Is it?
Yeah.
Okay. And that's the mapping. And then this was another activity that we've done. It was role play and hot seating. So talk kids through certain scenarios, and then they kind of put themselves in those scenarios and kind of walked and talked through what they could do to come up with solutions around that. And this was, I'll show you in the video as well, an activity where we designed this kind of workshop to kind of design a utopia or a great kind of picture of how people need to be coming into school. The reason behind this activity was that the kids were colouring in, but we were able to talk and engage with them while they're colouring in and doing stuff. And that interaction while they're colouring in, that was quite important, the way that was happening. So that was the whole purpose of this workshop, that it was kind of learning through play.
And then the important thing is that it was local to them, so everything that they were putting on there was contextual to the actual solving of the problem. So they were, we've mentioned the Waitrose, and we've mentioned the school and the routes to it, and where the clean roads are. They knew that already because they'd done that, and where the dirty roads are. And they then started producing a graphic around that information and their creativity.
Some of the other outcomes, this is still being refined, but this is a big banner that's going to go outside the school for parents. And then this is also going to be turned into a little bit of print material as well, and that's going to be given out. So this is it's going to be like 2 meters by 1 meter. And there's like, 5 top tips that we found about ways to kind of reduce our levels of exposure as well to air pollution. So the whole idea of this is that we're trying to work with, we've designed a model where we're working with corporates and we're trying to work out how they can get involved and feed into the project that we're doing. They were really interesting to really understand that how they could get involved. So that's kind of where we're at the moment. There's another project for indoor air quality, that's what we're working on at the moment. Phil started working on this with the pretty good design agency in Farringdon. But I'll quickly whiz through this. So we already know that plants have this whole pollution busting thing about them, and NASA's done this amazing study on it. I'll just quickly fly through some of these slides. So we worked with the horticulturist expert Palmer and Flux.
He's the guy we've got for the green wall.
Oh, you're right. Yeah,
really nice guy.
So it comes from the ethos of biophilia, so the biophilic study of why are we connected, or why are we humans are connected to nature, but sometimes we don't know, there's a disconnection there. There's a great book also by Richard Love called Men and Men. That's probably something to check out. But Edward Wilson was the person behind the biophilic study. So in 1984 he came up with this hypothesis that humans naturally are connected. Why do we go out and we get fascinated visually by these sceneries, and why do we have pets? That connection with animals is all apparent as well. NHS also have done this really good study of restorative spaces. So what they've noticed is that these green spaces, people and patients, when they have access to these green spaces, it helps them recover much quicker. And this is a NASA study. You can tell it's a little while ago. But they've done this amazing thing where they actually tested these pollution busting plants, and what ones actually work for VOCs indoors and what ones work for certain other gases as well. Harvard have done a really interesting study on this as well, where they've actually pumped in different types of air and measured productivity as well in offices. A really interesting study there as well.
So everything you're seeing here, you can clearly apply to learning environments, and especially around young kids, with bodies that are still growing, you can probably see the benefits, not just in the workplace, but more so for us within the young school age groups that we were looking at.
Yeah, so the idea was that this was meant to be a layer for schools as well, that we could do an intervention at schools where we bring certain plants into schools to help clean up the inside classrooms.
So yeah, it'd have the benefit obviously of the biophilic intervention as well as cleaning the air. But we're still testing that. So
this is the office before. and this is the office afterwards.
Wow, it's like a botanic garden. It's fantastic.
Yeah. So you can notice as well, so before and after, and psychologically this has a huge impact. We're still going through the process, we're recording and doing some videos. This is going to be a little video that we're going to shoot out later on as well. But you know, people are coming into it and saying, well, you know, I never would have come into the office over the weekend, and now I'm coming in over the weekend to work. It's just a great place to be. So the psychological benefits is huge. Yes.
I wonder if there's been any research done whether the effect is just is visual, but or also the smell.
Yeah.
So that's all part of the biophilia. There are basically 14 principles to biophilia, and we were testing the visual aspect clearly, and then the all of your senses is another aspect of it as well. So there's principles within biophilic kind of design, if you like, that we were testing within this phase, and we've got three phases. This is the first phase, and it was just the basic. Let's show some greenery and growing plants, and people start, you know, actually watering the plants and touching the plants. So there's that kind of whole interaction stimulus, I suppose, for people at work, rather than just being a fairly, not I wouldn't even say a dull office by many standards. We gave it the extra texture of nature within the workplace, I think. And everything that goes along with that at this stage. But there are other phases where we're going to be testing different aspects of biophilia. But this was just the first phase that's really connected to air quality as well. So, that's the reason we've shown it.
What also made this unique, because Phil came up inside over Darren, that it'll be great if this is dynamic as well. So people are able to move these planters. They're not just rigid, they're not just stuck there. And they're able to kind of divide and change the space.
We didn't really design it. We let them play around with it. Yeah. So they use their space very flexibly. They'll have their own seminars within their space, and so they were redesigning their space using the plants as almost flexible ways of directing people, which was a really cool outcome for us.
We've done some measurements for this device, but still more work I feel needs to be done around this. That insight that we're getting anyway from people generally, that they are just generally feeling better around the plants, was a huge thing for us. So that's going to be put into videos as well later on. And that's it. Oh yes, sorry, there is a video. I'll just quickly show you. It's a 2-minute video. We're just going to shoot around.
Is it on here, is it?
Yeah, I think so.
That's
already open. So it's going to
High Street is notorious for breaking the EU legal limits for air quality and air pollution. That data can be found online on the London Air website, and all of that modelling is done by King's College University as well. So nitrogen dioxide, the particulate matter, are quite high. Unfortunately, there's a school just over here that my kid goes to, and there's many streets like this around London that are very close to primary schools. Something needs to be done about it, and that's part of the reason why Climate Labs came to the school over here to come up with a solution. So we used mapping techniques, number one, to go around and identify where some of these pollution hotspots were. Alongside using Dr. Ben Barrett's equipment from King's College, we brought in some new innovative tech that was new to the market. We came back and mapped some of those key areas, which is a really interesting exercise for kids, probably one of the best exercises for kids. And then we moved on to this creative learning through play, where we got kids to actually work with some of the material that we have put in front of them. And while we are creating this landscape of the future, the team of the future, we are having that engagement and conversation with the children, allowing them to understand and talk about sustainable transport, what ways of coming into school, what they could possibly do to tell their parents about we can park further away and stride into school. So that was done through engaging kind of framework, which is quite interesting. Climate Labs is built on the UN SDG goals, and we try to address as many of those as we work forward with some of the projects that we design as interventions for this type of social and environmental change. So kids are future guardians of our planet. If we miss generations and unfortunately don't get a chance to raise awareness about critical issues that will impact them when they get older, unfortunately that leaves the world in a very undesirable place.
Take questions for both.
Yeah.
And that way, yeah, make sure everyone gets a chance to speak and we can hear the whole.
Shall we have a quick introduction?